Good afternoon. Let's start.
Interesting.
just trying to. Power. This is the master and this is the slave?
Maybe. Judging from the monks next door, yes, probably.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, okay. Interesting.
But don't kick the table because it gets upset.
It says no signal from the computer, which is interesting. Okay. Okay, that was essentially a connector problem. Well, first power and then connector problem. Finally. Okay, blue sheets are going. Please sign. The usual note well, which says, you know, everything you say is recorded and could be used against you. Proposed agenda. There was a request on the mailing list to actually change the order. Do people have any feeling about order, which is essentially the numeric node ID being discussed like 2.5 in the current proposed agenda. Any, you know, feeling of yes, no, maybe? Don't care? Do it? Okay, so 5 becomes 2.5. Any other comments or agenda bashing? So we have a one hour and 30 minutes meeting time. We'll try to go through the list of presentations, it's really a connector problem. Sorry. It's really the connector on my laptop. I'm not sure it's okay. Thanks. Sorry. I think it's on the laptop itself. Okay. Woo. I lost control of my Mac. Okay, whatever. So it's an hour and a half, and if I come back with, could you maybe back up, be my backup, because we may have issues with mine. So we'll try to go through the list in order, and depending on time, we may not have time. So let me switch to next slide, which is, you don't see it, which is because my Mac is just running like crazy. Administrative, we need JabberScribe and note takers. Any volunteer? Oh, thanks, Ed. And I was going to show the milestones of the charter, but since we still have a problem with my Mac, so can you get the Scott for the first presentation? Looks like I need to reboot or something. Yeah, bundle product. house. Reboot.
Great. Okay. We're set to start? Yeah. Okay. Good. I'm Scott Burley, JPL. I'm going to be talking about the work we've been doing on developing a successor to RFC 5050, the original bundle protocol specification from the DTN research group. And here's a summary of the of the status of that book. It was posted on the 21st of June, and there's a link to it there. Authors were me and Kevin Fall and Ed Berain. And what we did was we started with a draft from 2014 that had itself been adapted from the original RFC 5050 text, and we starting from that draft, took out things that we just, among the three or four of us, did not have consensus on, inserted some things that I think we did have consensus on, and there are still a good many things in that book that remain open issues, and I'll cover those in a couple of minutes when I get to those slides. The book includes a summary of the ways in which the new specification differs from RFC 5050, and it includes a list of the technical issues on which we do not yet agree, and that it'd be great to get some agreement on some of these in this meeting if we can, but by all means we should talk about it on the mailing list and try to resolve these things. We're trying to get this book out in a shortish time, on the order of a year. Would be nice to get an RFC out. And I think we're making good progress toward that, and I'd like to continue the progress. Next slide. Okay, so the differences from RFC 5050, there's three slides of these, and it's interspersed with one slide that sort of amplifies one of them. There's a clarification of the difference between transmission and forwarding, and the difference essentially being that transmission is what the source of the bundle does to insert it into the network, and forwarding is what every node along the end-to-end path from the source to the destination does to advance the bundle's progress toward the destination. And so forwarding includes what the source does, but also all the other forwarding nodes do the same thing. Something that I've been arguing for a long time, introducing the notion of a node ID that is distinct from an endpoint ID, because in fact nodes are distinct from endpoints. An endpoint is a set of nodes, and there are some functions in the operation of the protocol that apply to nodes rather than to endpoints, and it makes sense to me to identify those things. However, the node ID, while it's a concept that's a first-class concept in the book, is syntactically indistinguishable from an endpoint. We came to, a grand compromise on this, that the format of endpoints and of endpoint IDs and of node IDs is the same. They differ in that there's constraints on the use of node IDs, and there's a discussion on the next slide on the internal or coded on the wire representations of these. The encoding of the endpoint IDs in a transmitted bundle is just go into that a little further. The dictionary mechanism that is in the RFC 5050 from a long time ago, I think everybody has agreed that it's too cumbersome and doesn't really buy us anything. It's very difficult to work with, and so we're looking for an alternative way of doing a compressed representation of endpoint IDs and including node IDs when that's needed. And that's what's going to be on the next slide here. And then the other thing I wanted to point out at this point is the specification includes a fairly fundamental restructuring of the primary block to make it immutable. The idea being really two purposes there. One, to make it easy to apply CRC optionally across the entire primary block so that you protect it end to end. The other being in the back of our minds is we'd like to try to move the bundle protocol toward being a little bit easier than it is right now to implement in hardware or firmware so that commercial products can take it up more easily. And for that purpose, it looks like it might be better to keep the primary block immutable end to end. The extended class of service features are added to that, and that's an open issue to discuss. There's some controversy over which, if any, of those features need to be in the spec. There's an optional CRC on the primary block, as I mentioned before, and there's an optional inventory structure, which is something that is responding to something that Ellen was asking for at the last meeting, some way of detecting when blocks of a bundle had been added or removed in transit, different from when it was originated. And that also is open for discussion, whether that mechanism is a good way of doing it or not. Next slide. Sure. Yeah, absolutely. Sure.
If Owen Davis, if the inventory is going to be in there and the bundle changes during transit, then it's no longer immutable. That's no longer immutable because you've got to change the inventory. Or is the inventory intended to be the initial inventory?
The intent was that it was the initial inventory, and it did not change all the way through because the inventory of blocks at any point in the end-to-end path, you can perceive by just looking at the blocks and counting them. The point is to notify the receiver if any blocks that are in the received bundle are different from those that were inserted by the sender. So if that's not the intent, if that's not the thing that you were looking for, then we should rethink it and look at doing it a different way. But that was the intent of the mechanism. Okay, so next slide. Endpoint ID syntax. We're leaving the endpoint ID syntax unchanged from RFC 5050. It's a URI, same as it has been all along. And here are a couple of examples of that. There's a DTN scheme URI shown here and an IPN scheme URI here. The IPN scheme is the one that was devised to make compressed bundle header encoding possible. What the spec attempts to do is make CBHE unnecessary by defining an encoded representation of endpoint IDs as they appear in the primary block that is itself compressed in the event that that the scheme of the endpoint ID is a numeric scheme and therefore lends itself to binary compression. The details of that are in the spec. We can talk about that if we want to. Here are a couple of examples of it. The compressed representation of the DTN scheme EID in the first bullet looks like the first bullet under the first sub-bullet under the second major bullet. The only difference being that the scheme name DTN is omitted and it's replaced by a single octet that is a scheme identifier that is in binary form. And there's a convention on those scheme identifiers such that I think it's something like all scheme identifiers from 1 to 127 are, or maybe 63, are for numeric schemes, and all others are for string schemes. And the compressed representation of the encoded representation of a numeric endpoint ID is essentially a sequence of SDNVs, one for each of the numbers represented in the scheme specific part of the URI, and for the non-numeric endpoint ID schemes, the encoded representation is something to be defined in the definition of the scheme. By default, it's just copying the scheme-specific part intact. The string gets copied into the primary block. And just by way of analogy here, this is similar to the way we have an external human-readable representation of an IP address like 127.0.0.1. But the internal representation, looks quite different, and that's really what we're going for here. Next slide. So continuing with the differences from RFC 5050, the second page of this, there's a clarification that the class of service field is priority, and the size of that field is increased from 2 bits to 7 bits, and this is also sort of inherited from the extended class of service internet draft. The larger number of priorities is something that the Japanese National Space Agency asked for. They apparently do transmission where they order their or at least wanted to order their transmitted data by on the order of 15 to 20 different priority classes. But as Ellen has pointed out, prioritization, not everybody is interested in doing it, and not everybody knows how to do it, and it sort of doesn't make sense to let anybody say this is high priority data and it goes in front of your data, which you think is high priority, and you just didn't happen to pick a large enough number for it. So there's language in the spec now that says prioritization is prioritization within a single source. So a single source node, the bundles emitted from that source can be ordered by priority. The ordering of bundles from multiple sources by default is just sort of FIFO, but there could be some overriding definition of that in the specification of the flow label extension block that shows up on the next page, I think. There's CRCs, the option to have a CRC on not only the primary block, but also the non-primary blocks. There's a new block ID number that would be part of the canonical block format, and that is to make the streamlined bundle security protocol more functional. The individual BSP blocks need to be able to reference other blocks, and having a number they can use to do that is a great simplification over what we're doing right now. There's an amplified discussion of custody transfer. The current custodian is moved into an extension block, and that's again to protect immutability of the primary block because the current custodian changes from point to point through the end-to-end path. And there's a definition of the current custodian block in the spec. Not a very complete definition, probably needs to be more. There's also other extension blocks that are added to the spec. There's a bundle age extension block that addresses the need that's been identified for some time to support nodes where there is no guarantee that the node has got an accurate clock. And so the creation time isn't necessarily a good way to clock out the time to live. The previous node ID extension block, which is already defined in an RFC in from the research group. The flow label block, not defined in the specification, that's something for future work. The hop count extension block that Will Ivanchik in particular has been asking for a long time. And also an extension block that may or may not be used depending on the operational scenario. There's a small point, a disconnection between the rules for fragmentation and the rules for custody transfer that Ed Berain pointed out, and that's addressed in the spec. And the last point is that the administrative records have got these very high resolution DTN times of occurrence of the things that the status reports are reporting on, and that seemed unnecessary. You've already got a creation time in the bundle header. Why do you need those times? Since this document went out, I've heard from Carlo Caini at University of Bologna that for some of the research that he's been doing, those times are really, really useful. So he's saying, don't get rid of them. And we sort of agreed between us, oh, how about we just make them optional so that you don't have to carry that extra weight if you don't care about them. But for research where you really do want those times, you can request them and have them supplied when the status blocks are status reports are sent out. Okay, so that's all the differences between the spec and RFC 5050 right now. Ed.
Hey, Scott, this is Ed. A question from Will Ivanchik on the chat room. The extension blocks that we've defined here, are they mandatory to be processed by every BPA?
I think the answer there is that we've got language in the specs that says what to do if you don't know how to process an extension block. My inclination would be to say, as long as you adhere to those rules, the extension blocks that you process or don't process is up to you. Your implementation may not work very well if you don't support all the extension blocks, and people may not use it for that reason. But I don't think it's my inclination is to say it's not productive to mandate the extension blocks. And let me just add one point to that. We say extension blocks, and I think people have the sense that extension blocks are things that are like sort of disposable and sort of second class, unlike things that are in the primary block that are always there. And I would like to discourage that perception. In my mind, the extension blocks are absolutely first class elements of the protocol specification and of the operation of the protocol. And just because something is an extension block doesn't mean it's like unimportant. And I would like to have everybody sort of dispel that from their minds. I think Ed had a follow-up.
Just a brief follow-up is that as we go through this, then we should understand why an extension block definition would be in this specification versus its own specification. And does being in this specification imply a certain level of need to implement versus it being in its own specification?
I think that's a very reasonable thing to add some language for in the spec. Absolutely. I and my answer would be that the things that are in these extension blocks are things that the working group has identified a priori as things that we think are important and relatively simple. And the field is open for lots of others, including, of course, the bundle security, which is its own separate book. But we have not anticipated all of those in this book, and we don't plan to, don't feel we need to. I think it's Kevin's turn.
Kevin Fall. So where he went on the Ed? Other side, Bill. Ed, sorry. Ed. Yeah. Just Kevin's opinion. I would expect over time we wind up with the host requirement RFC-like equivalent thing that says the minimum specification of required implementation will be this, 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 this. This will be the default values for those things. This will be that kind of stuff. Because I have a feeling after, you know, assuming this is successful, then people will actually figure out the right things. But these are ones that I guess the right thing is that people have advocated for them and not made a convincing argument against.
Right.
Is that kind of the realm
that's
here?
That's right. Yeah, right.
I had a small comment also on this last one because I didn't know about the conversation you just said. I mean, a higher precision time, is that a thing that is potentially applicable to things other than status messages and administrative stuff?
It's potentially applicable, but I don't know of and would be interested to hear a reason why it's needed and the cases in which it's needed. In the specific case of the status reports, Carlos says he needs them for very precise kind of timing things that he's doing over the network, and I'm comfortable with that as long as they're optional. And if we need it for other purposes as well, that's great. I am aware of the size of these things, and I prefer to keep the size of everything as low as we can because we've got constrained links in many cases. So I'd rather not send these things unnecessarily. That's my concern.
Ron Mainfeld, I like what you're saying about extension blocks being first-class citizens. However, I have not quite grasped why then the primary block has to be immutable, but the extension blocks can be mutable. Because if they're more susceptible to being tampered with, they're in effect, they are second class citizens, I think.
The point of an optional CRC in the canonical block format is precisely to protect against the unintended mutability of the extension blocks. But it is the design intent of the extension blocks, I think, to provide flexibility that you can add things, you can remove things. And it is the fact that they are added and moved doesn't make them less important. It makes the addition and removal of those things part of their function. So I again don't see that as an argument for saying that they're second class citizens in any way.
They just don't get the same level of protection.
Sorry?
They just don't get the same level as of protection against tampering.
Well, they can have their own CRCs, absolutely. It's just that they can be the CRCs are optional, just as the CRC on the primary block is optional, and the primary blocks in the non-primary blocks can be deleted and removed. And yeah, that's in the nature of the non-primary blocks.
Marc Blanchet, as an individual. Two questions. Experience with IP, both V4 and V6, is almost every header options were never used and at the end dropped, roughly speaking.
Yeah.
Are we trying to do wishful thinking here in having a lot of extension blocks that will never be used and will be in a position to deprecate later. I understand that, you know, and I think I'm making the comment based on moving from research to, you know, standards and, you know, where we have to be much more, cutting stuff only putting stuff that, because we would, you know, there's all kinds of dependencies on this, which is, you know, complexity of code, of implementations, you know, embedded systems and, you know, all those stuff. So, how can we, you know, make sure that it's the right way to do? Because, for example, I see flow label and there's a few things that, you know, do we really need them or, you know?
Right. And I am fine with moving the definitions of at least some, maybe all of the extension blocks into other books. I just am leery of saying we're going to do more documents when we've been told we're not doing more documents, right? So since I think it's important to define these things in the first round, either that's going to be in different drafts or
Well, there's documents
we're allowed to do, or they need to be in this draft.
Well, there's documents, and then related to what you know was previously discussed, which is probably more strict in what should or must be implemented, and maybe or and well, then be so more much more you know. When we say must implement, then we ought to be sure that this is really needed for all implementation and everything should, you know.
No,
so
I,
we need to be.
I agree with that, sure.
I think we need to be very, very clean cut in making sure that everything which is not, you know, which could be optional is put, you know, kind of really clear as optional. And
absolutely. And maybe that means that the supplementary document that Kevin was talking about needs to come out sooner so that all those musts are in place. And that's, I don't argue either way on that.
My other question is about encoding of the, if you can go back like next. So why are you doing this?
Oh, well, because for link bandwidth constrained environments, we want very small.
Save a few bytes.
Sorry?
Save a few bytes.
Yeah, that's exactly. Yeah. In this particular case, the numbers I picked because I was going to have to do some binary arithmetic on them are small numbers, and so yeah, the compression from 10 bytes to 4 bytes only saves you 6 bytes, but it's 6 bytes for maybe 3 different endpoint IDs in the primary header. That's 18 bytes, and for a bundle that's 130 bytes long, that's a lot. So yeah, save a few bytes. Exactly. That's exactly what it's for.
Okay, I somewhat disagree.
small comment.
I work in an environment where if I were not able to say this, the protocol would not be used. That's bottom line. It's flat. It would not be used.
Okay.
So Mark. It's Kevin again. This was a direct compromise conversation, right, between the CBHE structure and its kind of compressed numbers, and how do we still maintain kind of the flexibility that came from the other version? That's where it, and sort of as argued by the point you just heard.
Yeah.
Rick Taylor. Exactly. Sorry, Rick Taylor. Going back to the previous point about extension blocks, is the problem here that they're called extension blocks rather than specifying that these blocks must be in the primary block and are immutable, optional. There's more classification here than just calling them extensions. And it's going back to your point of don't treat these things as second class citizens. It may just be a terminology issue that using the word extension implies it's an optional thing you can throw away in transit.
We could change the term, but I think actually the term is has the advantage of being accurate in the right. The intent is to be able to extend the protocol by defining new blocks.
Yeah,
that is the intent, and so I would like to think that we can just change our minds instead of changing the language.
Understood.
Kevin, I think that extension term came from extension headers, as is used in IPv6. And with respect to an earlier question that you asked, Mark, about, well, can we window this down to the minimum set? Most of those things that wound up here were ones that had some ongoing life in IP protocols after all of the getting rid of all the various ICMP things over the years.
Okay.
The last one, though, the time one, not so much. Flow label came directly, I think, from the flow label revision.
Right. Okay. So, yes, please.
I don't want to really go down this rat hole, but if you call something a primary block, then the rest sort of becomes secondary.
Right. So that's fine. I'm fine with like changing the name of the primary block, and we could call it initial block. How about that? If that's the sort of thing we need to do to fix everybody's minds on this, then that's great. Let's do that. Let's call it initial block. Am I okay for time here to go through the last slides, or do we need to cut?
To me, 50/50 bis is the foundation of everything else. So we somewhat need to discuss it at enough length, okay. So we have a move forward, because if 50/50 bis is not stable, then right. Everything else is even more or less stable.
I'm fine with that. I just thought I'd better ask. Okay, yeah. Let's go to the next slide then. So these are five pages of the open technical issues. These are all listed in section, I think, 13 of the specification. So you can read them at your leisure in more detail. These are just very high-level sort of thumbnails of the descriptions of the open issues. And there's like five pages of them. One issue is it's really not a technical issue. It's a document structural issue. The definitions section, there's a lot of stuff in the definitions. Is it overloaded? Should we not call it definitions, or should we break the definitions into multiple parts where there's a strictly a one or two line definition, and then later on a functional discussion of the same concept? I'm inclined to think that putting all the information on all of the discussion on, say, endpoint in one place is better than spreading it across multiple sections, but it does make for some dense reading as you're going through the definition section. So there's an argument to be made on the other side. The second one, the nomenclature for payloads. There's, and this is going back to 50/50. This is nothing new. There is this notion of the nominal payload being the original payload as transmitted. And fragmentary payload being a portion of that payload that is sent as the payload of a fragmentary bundle. And should we change the word fragmentary to partial? Would that be better? There's again just language issues there. It's not really a technical issue, strictly speaking. There's also a document issue rather than a technical issue is the description of the application agent. Is it needed? If it is needed, should we do more about it? Should we have like a diagram that explains it? That's, I think, something to discuss on the mailing list. The next two are, I think, kind of key points that I think there can be a lot of argument in both directions on. In RFC 5050, the source and the current custodian are both identified by endpoint IDs. In this revised specification, the source and the current custodian are identified by node IDs, because the reason being that we only have procedural definition in the spec for nodes being sourced or taken custody of by nodes. There isn't any definition in there for that enables an endpoint, which is a set of nodes, to be the source of a bundle or to be the custodian of a bundle. So that raises the question, is that okay? Do we want to provide for collective sourcing of bundles? Do we want to provide for collective taking of custody? And if so, then it's fine for those things to be endpoint IDs rather than node IDs. And if not, then the current language, I think, is correct. And we can talk about that now, or we can let it sit for a little bit and come back to it and move on to the next page.
I just have a small addition, Kevin, again.
Sure.
So I think this relates to, in the IP world, you know, multicast traffic only has a regular unicast source address. There's not a multicast source address as a concept IP provides, so we have some knowledge about that.
Right.
However, if you have an anycast-like situation, those are, for all intents and purposes, unicast addresses, such that just the routing handles them differently in different parts. So I think we have a fair bit of knowledge of how it could work, and in this case, thinking in terms of what we know there, to decide whatever you want to do is probably helpful.
Okay.
But the fact that we have a unicast address as the source in the multicast setting, and there doesn't seem to be a big momentum to have a multicast source address as something, and or even what that would mean, that would suggest to me that one source.
I am highly sympathetic to that view. That is exactly the right answer, I think, and likewise for custody. Elwin.
Yeah, Elwin Davis. I personally would say a definite no to these ones, because I can't see, particularly on the custody side, how you would do the coordination in a DTN environment. If you've got a coordinate between these various different things that have got a multi-point endpoint, and you're going to try and send things back. It's a DTN environment. It's going to take time to get things to and forth, and there might well be transactional type things. And I can't see it personally.
I again completely agree. Kevin.
All right, two more. Oops, on that one. RMT. What was RG, and then RG, right? The reliable multicast transport tackled this problem. Not saying that I'm actually not necessarily agreeing, or just a fact, right? They did this. They have at least two versions. One is the one that acknowledges everything, so there's a two-directional. But the other one they did was, which is Flute and ALK, relates to using things like erasure coding with no assumption of backchannel. So in that case, you don't ever even get an acknowledgement.
In which case, you're not really doing custody.
There's a high probability that you'll be able to reassemble the stuff.
Yeah, but that's sort of that's not custody then. I mean, if you don't get the acknowledgement, you can't have.
So we have we've had a concept of transmission over a one directional only.
Absolutely.
And I don't remember exactly what the solution of this is, but it seems like you don't any message regarding custody when that happens is an informational message that tells you, hey, I went over one direction, so I can't really give you a custody confirmation at this time.
Yeah.
Which is about all you can say, I think.
So, okay. There's another question over here, or another point.
It's Rick Taylor again. I think I'm agreeing with Kevin on this one. I think the multicast endpoint idea has some interesting concepts. Yes, there are problems with custody transfer, but I can see people saying, I'd like the multicast ability, and I can live without the custody transfer acknowledgement at that point. So preventing it altogether because we can't currently think of how to make it work seems...
Well, I absolutely would not say that we do away with endpoints that are multi-point. I think we absolutely have to have that.
Okay.
What I think we do not need, and I think is would require major work in the specification to define it, is an endpoint that takes custody and an endpoint that is the source of data. I think endpoints as destinations and endpoint as the report to, I think those make all the sense in the world.
Okay. Yeah, no, I
don't argue against those at all. In fact, I think those are indispensable. I think multicast is the future of DTN, really. And if we don't have it, I think we're sunk.
Okay.
It's probably premature to like, I'm thinking I would sort of like to ask for a hum on these two while we have people in the room that seem to be agreeing, but maybe that's premature. Pardon me? I'm sorry. Oh, no, hum on these last two points, just the last two points here, which I have not heard. I think I have not heard any argument against dispelling these two options.
Scott, I think we have. Yeah, I think you have five. Mark.
Yeah.
I think you have five slides, and you know, time is okay. So.
Okay. Fine. Let's. If we have time at the end, I'd like to do that, though. I'd like to come back to that. Okay. Next page. This is something that Kevin brought up in talking about the specification. If we provide for the possibility of using DTN to implement information-centric networking, do we need to change the definition of transmission or make some other sort of adjustment to enable a forwarding waypoint that has received a copy of a bundle to hold on to that bundle and then send it again to a late ICN bundle protocol ICN client who asks for it. And the options here are this is again transmission, even though the bundle was originated in the past, it's transmission by the forwarding caching node, or contrarily, it is just an additional forwarding by the caching node. And I think this is a real interesting topic. I think BPICN is an interesting topic. I don't think we're going to resolve that here. I think it's a topic for more discussion. okay. The next one is, should the bundle protocol spec be divided into two documents? It's not that big. It's like 54 pages, but maybe it would be useful to have one document that has sort of informational and illustrative and, you know, con ops and contextual information in it, and a separate document that is strictly the protocol specification, strictly the normative language. Concept of operations. This too, I think, is a good topic for the mailing list. The next one is a very small thing. It's just a question of the bundle security protocol. Are we going to name it Streamlined Bundle Security Protocol, or are we going to name it Bundle Security Protocol when the RFC gets published on it? And that's... it's really the only reason to come up with an answer there is what language do we use in this specification when we refer to it. The bundle format, right now the format of the bundles is described at the start of section 4. Should that be moved someplace else in the specification? Okay, next is an actual technical issue. Should the payload always be the last block in the bundle? And there's an argument for that. If it is, well, we get rid of the last block flag, which is possibly handy, and it might resolve at least some of the problems with reactive fragmentation, because part of the problem with reactive fragmentation has been anything that comes after the payload, by definition, did not make it to the receiver, and so because the receiver is reactively fragmenting it because it didn't receive the entire payload, and so it didn't receive anything after the payload. And so what do you do about those things? And that has been an obstacle to reactive fragmentation for some time. So I think it's kind of a good idea. Again, a good topic for the mailing list and this question.
No, it's just a comment. John Dowdle, Airbus. Just on the first point on your slide, there, Scott, I was sat in ICNRG on Monday, I think it was.
Oh, yeah.
They were talking about DTN in the context of ICNRG, and they were going, well, actually, we don't use any of that DTN rubbish. We want to do it ourselves. And mm-hmm. Just wonder if there ought to be some dialogue between our groups on what it is they actually want or haven't got from DTN.
That's a great topic for conversation, and we're not going to get into it right now, I think. We may get into it a little bit later, but not right at this moment. Excellent topic. Next slide. The SDNV discussion in section 4.1. We have a separate RFC for SDNVs. Should we just refer to it there? And here again, it's like it's there sort of as a service to the reader, so they don't have to look at another document. But if we lose it, it's not like the end of the world. Kevin has a comment on this.
Personal comment.
Yeah.
That argument.
Yeah.
You know, put it in there so as to make them not have to hit a link.
Yeah.
But then cause us to have to deal with that entire text as we carry it forward doesn't seem like an optimal trade-off to me.
That's fine. That's fine. This may be something on which we have an early consensus. The bit numbering convention is described in section 4.2. That's the bit numbering on the, I think, on the bundle processing flags. And there was a suggestion that be moved to the front of the document rather than where it's currently located. And this, again, is a document structure. It's not really a technical point, and we can discuss on the mailing list, and whatever we decide to do is fine with me. The extend class of service features, this is a technical point, and probably will take a fair amount of mailing list discussion to resolve. In particular, there's the critical flag that nobody understands why it's called critical and should be named something else. And if we have it, and if it is named something else, do we need it at all?
Coming in, I, lacking some other big argument about why to do it, it would seem to me we would look to the DSCP literature, if you will, about what to do with this thing.
Which thing?
The class of service field we have and what it might be used to encode or how it might be handled
mm-hmm.
may be related and leverageable upon the DSCP work in, you know, DiffServ.
Oh, okay.
In IETF.
That's good point. And let me just go back to the first bullet for a second. There is one other point which has been raised at one time or another is SDNVs. Do we like them or do we want to, like, use something else instead? And that also is a thing we can talk about on the mailing list or we can discuss here. The specification has some like a two-bit code field for CRC type for indicating whether or not there's a CRC on the block that applies to, and if so, what type of CRC? And that coding right now is very vague. It's just like how many bits is the CRC, not what the algorithm is. So we need to nail that down. That's not really controversial. It's just a general observation about the spec. The inventory mechanism, we mentioned that before. That also is something that we need to spend some time on the mailing list for. Does it serve the purpose it's intended to serve? And if not, should we be doing something else? And I think that's wide open for discussion. Next slide. Should the payload always have block number zero? This is a tiny point of spec. Given that the blocks are going to be numbered, and there's always a payload block, makes a certain amount of sense for it always to have the value that you know you're always going to have, which would be zero. But that's not necessary. We can decide to do it some other way if that is if we determine that's useful. This is next bullet is a feature that's left over from RFC 5050. It's been there for a long time. That nodes have been able to process an extension block and clear the block was forward without being processed flag that had been set by a previous node. Is that an okay thing? It's been part of the spec for a long time, but maybe it's not a good idea. Again, something for the mailing list. Can supplementary DTN protocol specs contradict the bundle protocol spec? It's clearly supplementary specs like bundle security protocol or whatever can add to the spec. Is it okay, or do we contemplate it being okay for a supplementary spec to contradict the bundle protocol spec, or does the bundle protocol spec in all conflicts always rule?
Kevin, I don't think this is a working group question. I think the IETF publication process answers it.
Oh, okay.
And the answer is, of course.
And
any subsequent document can make that one not right, right? Can change it, can make it obsolete, can make it do not comply with this document.
So when we do that, do we mark the bundle protocol spec obsolete?
That's an IETF process to decide.
Right, Kevin.
Okay.
Just to clarify, so if a future spec were to do something to the base spec, it could easily just be marked updated by.
Right. That's probably the most likely case.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. Oh, IETF. Yeah. Yeah. No, not CSSDS. Of course not. And the only reason this comes up is that language was in the spec originally, and looks like it ought to come out. There's a question of the time at which a bundle gets forwarded to the next node. And it's sort of, in a sense, this is, it's not an interoperability concern. It isn't going to affect the interoperability between two nodes that are doing bundle protocol. It's a guidance to the implementer, I think. The question there is, is the bundle protocol agent or the convergence layer adapter responsible for selecting the time at which something gets transmitted?
Kevin again. So I think that last question is implementation detail that doesn't belong here. I think as far as when the actual question of when it gets sent or forwarded is an intimately operational question, not guidance to the implementer. So for example, there may be reasons that I will be attacked if I emit energy at a particular moment in time.
Okay.
So that would be a pretty constraining policy operationally.
Okay.
And so some kind of policy is quite important in, if you will, the routing decision here or the forwarding decision that is beyond just an implementation decision of, you know, guidance. Now you could say, lacking such policy, we recommend doing this, if that's what you're trying to say. But I just wanted to say there may be things beyond just the implementation of this issue.
Okay, and I certainly acknowledge that, and we should nail that language down somehow, one way or another.
Owen again. And also technically, from the point of view of my point of view, this is something that routing decides, and we've ruled routing out of scope of this document. So basically, it would be the routing subsystem that decided on timing, potentially.
I really disagree with that, but it'll take some time to discuss why. So let's come back to it. And then the bullet at the bottom here is the DTN times question that I brought up earlier. Stephen.
So the controls the time, I think, it doesn't get mentioned, but I think you also, who controls the time, I don't think was in this document, but you also mentioned defining the time at which it gets sent.
I don't think I said defining.
Okay. So there's no, I mean, you know, there's no kind of transmission time, I don't think, anywhere in the new stuff, right?
No, nothing like that.
Good.
Yeah. Okay. And then I think the next one is the last page, which is just has one item on it, which is an idea that I think would be a simplification, but Ed and I have discussed this, and Ed strongly disagrees, so I'm putting it up here anyway because I sort of like the idea, which would be prohibiting multiplicity in extension blocks of any given type. That is, if you have an extension, you define a block for that extension, and all of the information pertaining to the processing of that functional extension to the bundle protocol for any given bundle goes into a single block. And if there's multiplicity, then it's internal multiplicity within that block. In some ways, I think that simplifies things because then, for example, you don't need a block number to identify which block bundle security protocol provisions apply to. You can just identify the block by the block type because there's only one of that type. But there are countervailing arguments, and I think we should again take this to the mailing list.
If you're taking it to the list, I'll take it to the list.
Yeah. It's, and I don't think this is the sort of thing we can resolve today. And that's the end of my slides. Are there any additional questions? Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Scott. So time management, we're 20 minutes, so we won't have all time to do all the slides that we're looking at the agenda. Actually, it's actually good that we have seen all the main milestones of this working group as appeared as internet drafts for this first meeting. But there's actually a lot of stuff to read and discuss. This specific week, we had a request from the ITF to actually reduce the number of slots because there were more requests than the number of slots. We actually decreased the initial request from 2 hours to 1 hour and a half to obey that demand. So what the co-chairs have discussed is to do virtual interim meetings, like once every month or something like that at that pace, so that we could make progress because we have a lot of stuff that may not go for forever, but maybe until Yokohama, we could have some pace of interim meetings, virtual interim meetings. So we don't need to do face-to-face to actually go through all the main topics of this working group and to compensate the fact that we have less time this time. So we saw almost no comments on the mailing list for almost all the drafts that were published, except yesterday, 1 day before the presentation. So it would be better if people read before, so we actually have time to, instead of rushing during the ITF week. Co-chairs would like to have a feeling of the working group if this document that was described is ready for working group adoption or not. So we'll ask a few questions. Please raise your hand if you have read this document. Okay, four or five. Okay. Yes. Do you think that the working group should adopt this document as it is right now or wait later? So do you think, or do not at all? So do you think we should adopt this document? Yes, Scott? So it's technically it's just a file name change. No. Well, so as now is the co-chair with the idea that is trying to interrupt the end of my sentence. So technically as a author, you would essentially change the file name and resubmit. But that means that the working group is actually agreeing that this is the base protocol, the base document for the milestones that is.
And the working group is responsible for the content of the document at that point.
Of course. Thank you. So it's no more individual document, but is a working group document. And Is that?
Yeah.
Okay. Do the author think that it's ready for working group adoption? Okay. Do the working group think it's ready for adoption as a working group document? Please, Okay. If you think it's not ready for working group adoption, please I've heard none. Okay, so thanks for the feedback. So we'll move to the next slide, which is based on the change of the agenda was the naming. Which means that the others have probably lost their slot. But we'll do, again, we'll schedule an interim meeting, kind of at the pace of one every month to, advance the work.
Fred? Okay. So this was to capture some of the discussion that went on the mailing list from several weeks ago about numeric naming architecture. Go ahead. So we know that the bundle protocol includes a URI-based naming scheme where each name can be up to 1023 bytes in length, but long names consume too much bandwidth for constrained links. So we also have an IPN naming scheme that gives short integer names to nodes. So nodes that obtain initial IPN delegations have a permanent performance advantage over latecomers, since a small node ID can be represented in fewer bytes than a longer node ID. So we're looking at a revised IPN naming scheme that's been proposed. Next chart. So in the revised IPN naming scheme, there's no change to the IPN representation. No node number assignment range is more advantageous than any other. And the node number has two components, a unit number followed by an agent number. Each unit's identified by a number that's 7 to n lengths, bits in length. Where ends between 1 and 8. The length of the agent number's unit is 63 minus 7 n bits, and the scope of the unit is all numbers that begin with this unit number. Unit number can be omitted from SDNB representations of the node ID in the same unit. So if we had a company all had the same leading component, we don't have to include that in our on-the-wire representation. And the unit number can be encoded in an extension block when it's necessary. Next chart. So then we've also proposed a TLV-based naming scheme. The new scheme type as the type, the second octet being the length encodes the length of the value field. So value fields encode a numeric name. The name consists of a 24-bit organization code followed by a numeric node ID specific to the organization. So organization code somewhat in the same spirit as the IEEE 802.11 MAC addresses, 802 MAC addresses. The most significant bit in the L octet is the organization code present bit, And so for communications belonging to the same organization, the 24-bit organization number can be admitted. Leading all zero octets are not transmitted over the wire. So a couple of examples of how we can have some compression based on the node IDs that are encoded. Next chart, that might be it. And we have a draft on this. Since posting this draft, I've become aware of a coding scheme called CBOR, which stands for Compressed Binary Object Representation. That might be another alternative to the TLV and the alternate IPN naming schemes. So I plan to do some investigation of CBOR to see if that might give us some compression advantages. I see one person going to the mic.
This is an organizational question rather than a technical question. If one adopted this, who would manage the organization numbers?
We were thinking IANA.
Kevin, just a related question. You said they're like the OUIs.
Oh, kind of got dorked. Okay. OUIs, right? These are OUIs from IEEE.
Yeah.
Why not just use those?
So
what's that? No, I mean they're organizational unique identifiers. They've been traditionally used in that way, but that's not the only possible ever use of them, right?
So the OUI
now you have to buy them might be an interesting comment. Okay, so
right. Yeah.
I'll just espouse a particular philosophy we've had, which is we've evolved a name structure in general over these years that has tried to have the ability to adopt other people's energies into creating and maintaining all their name structures. So at least when I hear a proposal for let's create a new one that we'll manage, the default thought is, well, is there one that would just do that already? But
we would like to have a fresh start with no population in the registry.
For what
to
reason?
Start from. So that we can have more organizations claiming more OUI space or organization.
You believe that the however many bits that are allocated to that is insufficient for what this world of this protocol spec will go?
Well, so some truth in advertising. If you had an organization code, and the first few nodes that you number out of your organization code would have the ability to compress down to a smaller number of bytes because there would be leading zeros.
Yeah.
So what we have to avoid is a land grab for people going out and buying up lots of organization codes. So there is some concern about whether we're going to have enough organization codes to go around.
So IANA already have the private enterprise numbers.
Yeah.
So what's wrong with that? I mean, loads of people have them. They're free.
They're 32 bits. Do we want to spend 32 bits of our 64 allotted bits on the organization number or the enterprise number? I'm sorry.
But they're not using all 32 bits, though, right?
So Stephen, I, Mark and I were just talking about this, and we're trying to decide if it actually makes sense to even try and figure out how we would do it until we decide if we want to do it. Sure. Right?
Yeah. Right. Requiring a new naming registration scheme when there exists some already would be kind of fatal. Especially or picking that costs money. I mean, that's not going to work.
Hello, I'm Feng Moha from Beijing Jiao Tong University. My question is, what is the node number used for? Is it used for routing or just to identify the node? And what is the difference between the endpoint identity?
It identifies the node. It's not used in routing because we have late binding that binds the node ID to the address in the address space. In terms of node ID versus endpoint ID, I think we're talking about node IDs at this point.
I guess maybe this is too much of an ask, but it sort of seems like the question of compressed / binary IDs, how they're used and how to encode them, would be a really good DTNRG thing that we could make maybe an experimental RFC, and if we're all happy with it, we'd just cross-reference it.
Are you looking for a justification for a research group? Or?
That, sorry, that was too easy.
So this started as the IPN scheme, but it seems fairly apparent, the binary thing you talked about and right. Scott talked about, it's not really tied to IPN at all, right? It's just a name you chose that had a certain connotation for you. So the idea that you might want these short things, I mean, people have made that argument. If we want to do that, it breaks up other thing. How is it encoded? Is there a namespace? I mean, all that stuff that comes up to some degree, the question that was just asked. So, I mean, there are some questions there that I could just as easily, it seems to me, be pursued and then brought in as done.
Right, yeah. Right, of course. Yeah, research might include also looking at some of these other encoding schemes like CBOR. And actually, the question might become a larger question for the bundle protocol. Do we want to look at different encoding schemes than SDMD? So, sure. I think that's it.
Okay, so if the clocks in the back of the room are correct, we have just under 5 minutes, or just about 5 minutes. Mark and I were talking about essentially one of two options. Fred could either rush through his key management presentation, or we could talk about any particular logistics for interim calls. Would people prefer to talk about interims or key management?
Is key management something that can be rushed? That's my question.
That right. And that right.
If you're asking me, I think I'd prefer not to rush through the slides.
And I think that's the preference. So, the idea that Mark and I had for the interims, as Mark said earlier, probably like once a month or so, in order to give people a reasonable amount of time to recover from this week. We'd probably be looking at something towards the end of August. And the only thing I can immediately think of is people in the European region who would be on vacation. Is that a concern for anybody? Okay, Kevin overrules anybody from Europe who want to be on vacation. Would anybody have a problem with us scheduling the first conference call, say like the last week of August? I got a thumbs up from one person and a head shake from others, so nobody's screaming bloody murder, so we'll shoot for that. Any other last minute topics or comments, questions that people want to bring up? Run, Scott.
Just to seize on this moment while we're all here, there was that one suggestion I had earlier about maybe doing a hum on those two items. Is that a worthwhile thing to try to do now?
If we can go back to the slides fast.
Yeah, we've been on slide 4 or 5, I think. Back one. Oh, that's
that
it.
One.
Sorry, 6. Oh, seven. Right. So those last two bullets.
So why don't you do it yourself?
Okay. I will try to do this. And let's take them one at a time. Would those of us who feel that we should try to define a procedure by which a set of nodes collectively transmits a bundle, which is a change from what's in the current specification, that is collective source of a bundle, and as opposed to the current state, which is that a node is the source of a bundle. Everyone who is in favor of making that change, please hum. And would everyone who is opposed to making that change please hum? So I believe that's that idea is defeated. Does that sound right? Okay. Okay. Now, the last of these bullets, the same general question, but now instead of the source of a bundle, we're talking about the current custodian of a bundle. Would everyone who is in favor of defining some new procedures by which a set of nodes can collectively take custody of a bundle, which we don't have now, so that an endpoint can take custody of a bundle, would everyone who's in favor of making that change and moving away from the custodian of a bundle being a node, please hum? Would everyone who is opposed to that idea, please hum?
You don't have, in both cases, a clear yes or no, but, you know, slightly no for both, but, you know, so not completely conclusive, but.
Well, if it's not completely conclusive, then we should come back to it, I guess.
But, yeah.
But we could vote again and people could hum more enthusiastically.
Come to the ITF.
Rick Taylor, from my perspective, is that the room saying, don't stop 50-50 BIS for these two topics, but there is some interest in perhaps DTNRG for, yeah, there could be some cool things out there doing this stuff, but don't stop 50-50 BIS now to try and fix these problems. Is that about right? Is that what we heard?
That was my interpretation, yeah. But I think just to make sure that we're clear on that, Mark and I will actually craft questions to the mailing list with the exact interpretation to make sure that everyone is able to voice their opinion. All right, unless there's anything else, thank you very much for coming, and we will hopefully speak to you in August and see you in Yokohama. Thank you.